The following is a class on the Bhagavad Gita as it is, 3rd chapter, text number 13 through 16, given by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, recorded in the summer of 1966 in New York.
Jaggasista Sino Santa Mutyante Sarvakilmisai Bunjante te adhang papam je pachyanti atma karana. This verse we are discussing last meeting, that we should eat after offering sacrifice. Lord Krishna says that things which are eatable we receive by the grace of the Lord, we should acknowledge it. We should not be forgetful that our eatables which come to us, they can be manufactured by our sweet will. No. The arrangement is so nice in the administration of nature that we shall get all our necessities of life by the grace of God, and our duty is to advance ourselves in the right knowledge of our spiritual existence without unnecessarily engaging ourselves for sense gratification. That is the difference between human civilization and animal life. The beginning of our Bhagavad Gita lesson is based on that we are spirit consciousness. We are not this body. And the whole function of the human society is to be enlightened in that spiritual consciousness of life, instead of wasting time in sense gratification like the animals who are concerned with eating, sleeping, fearing and mating. That is the hope, that is the background of our this discussion, that we are different from the ordinary animals. So the common factor of animal life and human life is these four principles of bodily demands, namely that we require to eat and we require to sleep, we require some defensive measures for protecting ourselves from the enemies, and we require some extent of sense gratification. That is the needs of my body. They are not the needs of myself as I am, spirit soul. Oh. Now, if I want to get rid of this bodily encasement or the threefold miseries of material existence, then I must put myself under treatment. Just like a diseased man goes to a physician for treatment to get out of it, to get relief from the sufferings of the disease. Similarly, our material existence consisting of threefold misery and birth, death, old age and diseases, if we are actually conscious for our happiness, we must make a permanent solution of this misery. That is the mission of human life. So, for making that mission fulfilled, we have got developed consciousness than the animals. That developed consciousness should not be misused only for the animal propensities of life. That is the whole thing. And therefore, Lord Krishna says that in order to reach to that stage of perfection, you should work. Your work should not be stopped. We have already discussed this point that niyata kuru karma tam tanma dhyayo dhakarmana, that your prescribed duty should be prosecuted nicely, go on, don't stop it, but work for the life of karma yoga. Karma yoga. Ordinary work is called karma. Ordinary work is karma. And when it is added with yoga, that means spiritualized work. Yoga. Yoga means spiritual perfection. Or linking up with the Supreme. So, karma and karma yoga, there is no such difference. Karma means ordinary work. I work whole day. I get some remuneration and enjoy for my sense gratification. That is called karma. In this life or that life. Next life. Somebody, they make charities and other pious acts so that in their next life they get good parentage, good education, and opulence so that they can also enjoy life. There are others also who make more advanced karma to get himself promoted in other planetary system, just like moon planet or Sargaloka, heavenly planet. There are many planets in which the standard of life is far, far comfortable than here. So, these are not required. To get yourself promoted in higher standard of life from A-class prisoner to from C-class prisoner to become A-class prisoner, that is not required. Bhagavad Gita does not teach us that you improve your life in the respect that you are now C-class prisoner, you become A-class prisoner. No. You should not remain a prisoner. You should get yourself this prison life. This material life is prison life. Just like in prison house, we are forced to undergo some sort of misery. We may agree or not agree, or we have to undergo. In prison life, you cannot deny. And the state agents are there. He prescribes some work, you must do it. If you say, no, I cannot do it, I am not accustomed to do it, no, then you will be again more punished. Similarly, this is our prison life. This material existence is our prison life. And Prakriti, nature, is the forceful agent. She is always enforcing us to do, to act. Prakriti kyamanani gunai karmani sarva. So this is going on. Now if you want to get rid of this imprisonment, then you should begin this karma yoga. Karma plus yoga. Yoga means in connection with the Supreme. That connection with the Supreme begins with this formula, yajna, sacrifice. What you are going to sacrifice, what you have got, everything is given by God. Anything which you possess, you have not brought anything with your birth. You have come naked from the womb of your mother, and when you shall die, you shall go naked. So whatever you possess, that is given to you for proper use. We should understand that. The whole resources of material nature, they are under your control for making proper use. You can live comfortably, you can eat comfortably, you can live peacefully without any creating animosities or quarrel with your neighbors, and proceed your spiritual life so that you get rid of this material existence. That is the whole program of material nature. But misusing our developed consciousness, we are trying to misuse the resources of material nature in a different way for aggravating the sense gratification. That is the whole mistake. So, Krishna says that whatever mistakes you have done, I don't mind, but you act in this way. Yajnat, you work. Suppose you have misused your developed consciousness in so many ways and you are now entrapped. Suppose you have started a very complicated industry. Now, if I say that this complicated industry is not required by you, you simply require some fruits and grains to eat, why you are engaging yourself into this complicated and dangerous form of earning your livelihood? Stop it. No, that is not possible. That is not possible. Now you are entangled. You cannot stop. Sri Krishna says that don't stop your work, but by the result of your work, you try to make sacrifice for the cause of the Supreme. Then your entanglement will be automatically losing. The whole energy which you apply in your industry, if the result is offered to Krishna, that means that energy is utilized for Krishna. Not for that industry, but for Krishna. That is the thing. Just like Arjuna. What was he? He was a military man. He was not a sage. He was not a learned Brahmin. He was ordinary, royal family, belonging to a royal family, kingly order, and a householder, family man, having children, wife, and a military man. But how Arjuna became the greatest devotee of Lord? The Lord sacrificed bhaktosi, priyosi me. My dear Arjuna, you are my very dear friend as well as a great devotee. Now, what is the reason? He was not a sannyasi. He was not a Vedanti, he was not a philosopher, nothing of the sort. Still, you will find in the fourth chapter, Lord says, oh, my dear Arjuna, you are very dear to me and you are my great devotee. Now, if a person becomes very dear to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, then what else he wants more? How he became so? He became by this karma yoga. Karma yoga. He was a military man, and the problem was before him whether to fight with his kinsmen or not. That was his problem. Now mind that, he was fighting man in the beginning, before hearing the Bhagavad Gita, and he remained a fighting man after hearing Bhagavad Gita. Similarly, suppose you are engaged in some particular type of war before hearing this Bhagavad Gita, and after hearing, understanding Bhagavad Gita, you will have to remain in the same position. Not that after hearing this Bhagavad Gita, as you are kindly coming here, you will have to take a dress like me and leave up your family connection and become a mendicant like me. No, no. It is not meant like that. You have to change your mentality, that's all. What is that mentality? That mentality is that you are working for your sense gratification and you have to change your mentality for gratifying the sense of the Supreme Lord. That's all. We are working, ordinary work means for working for our own sense gratification. I want to eat this. So I eat, I purchase from the market. Oh, this is very nice thing, very palatable to my tongue. Oh, purchase it, I shall eat it. Now, when you become conversant with the philosophy of Bhagavad Gita, you have to think whether this thing is palatable to the tongue of Krishna. That's it. Now you are thinking, let me purchase from the store this nice thing, it's very palatable to my taste. And when you actually become a learned scholar of Bhagavad Gita, at that time you will have to think whether this thing will be palatable to Krishna, that's all. The whole thing is there. When you learn that thing, when you want to please Krishna, not yourself, then you become an expert spiritually. That's all. So it is not very difficult. Very easy. Simply, we have to learn how to reach that stage of life. You haven't got to change anything. The same thing is done. The Arjuna, they was a military man, a householder, a family man, before hearing Bhagavad Gita, and he remained the same family man, the same military man, but he became a great devotee of the Lord. That technique we have to learn. That technique is that Arjuna in the beginning, he did not like to fight because he wanted to gratify his senses. He thought that I shall be happy if I do not fight with my kinsmen, because in the fighting my kinsmen will die and I shall be sorry. So what is the use of fighting like this? That means the whole thing, whole program is according to his own sense gratification. He did not know that this war field, this battle of Kurukshetra was organized by Sri Krishna to kill all unwanted men of the world at that time. All unwanted men of that world. That was his plan. Now, this was disclosed to Arjuna. In the 11th chapter we will find that, my dear Arjuna, I have given you all kinds of instructions to induce you to fight in this battle, but know you perfectly well that either you fight or do not fight, I do not mind. All these men who have assembled here, they are not going back home, they will be killed here. It is already settled. It is already settled. Now, if you want to take the credit, you can apply your hands for fighting. That's all. So, anything that is going on in this world, it is under the supreme supervision of the law. Mayadhakshena prakriti svete sacharasaram. In every, there is a philosopher saying, not a blade of grass moves without the will of God. It is actually the fact, everything. Now, we have to dovetail ourselves with that plan of the Supreme Law. That is called karma yoga. That is called karma. So Arjuna understood it and he dovetailed himself with the supreme will of the Lord. And when he was inquired whether you are going to fight or not, what you have settled after hearing Bhagavad Gita, he said, "Yes, Krishna, my illusion is now removed by your grace and I have decided to fight." That's all. Now that agreement of fighting, and in the beginning of Bhagavad Gita, not to fight, that is the difference. In the beginning, he was not in agreement with Krishna. He made so many arguments with Krishna against fighting, and at the end, he agreed, yes. He said, he became a yes man. So we have to become a yes man to the Supreme Lord. That's all. That is the perfection of our spiritual life. Now we are all no man. God says this, I say no. Stubborn, I say no. Now simply we have to say yes. That's all. In everything we say no at the present. Present formation of our existence is to say no anything godly. We say no. We shudder even by the name of God. We have come to this, we have come to a certain stage of our civilized life that you want to banish God altogether. Not only saying no, but we now prepare to agree to the point that there is no existence of God. So how much foolish we are becoming day by day in the name of advancement of civilization. You see? So we should correct this. Now we shall try to understand our position and try to say, yes, there is God and I am servant of God. That's all. You have to learn that thing only. No more we have to say that there is no God. We may say there is no God, but that does not mean that there is no God. You see? Just like an upstart, he says that I don't believe in the government. There is no government. I am all in all. So that madman say like that, that does not mean that there is no existence of government. He is a madman who says like that. So that sort of, I mean to say, madness, we should give up. We should be submissive. There is God. There is only example several times I have cited that existence of God can be perceived with very simple. What is that? Just like you can perceive your existence in this body by the consciousness. You have got consciousness. That is that point we have discussed several times. That consciousness is the symptom of your existence in this body. So long that consciousness is there, this bodily function is going on very nicely. Now, you are eating. You do not know how your foodstuff is going to the stomach, how it is being transformed into different kinds of secretion, how it is being transferred from the stomach to the heart, how that secretion becoming red and that red blood is again circulated from the brain to the toe. This nice machinery work is going on within your body. This physical and physiological condition is present in your body. You are taking your foodstuff, the necessary and juice, vitamins are taken by the stomach, it is distributed, and the exhaustion of your body is supplemented, and the unnecessary things evacuated by stool, urine. The nice thing is going on. Now, as soon as this consciousness is stopped, will this function go anymore? No. You will find the same brain is there, the same heart is there, the same stomach is there by dissection of the body. You will see the same veins, everything is there, complete. But only thing is wanting, that consciousness, therefore everything is stopped. This is a common factor, everyone can know it. Similarly, the whole cosmic manifestation which is present before you, so nicely going on, don't you think there is a consciousness behind it? How can you deny that there is no consciousness in the matter of sun rising, moon rising, seasonal changes, and so many planets floating in the air? So many wonderful things are being done in the material nature. Do you think it is without being done consciousness? No, there is also consciousness. Just like for the management of your own body, due to the consciousness, everything is being well done. Similarly, everything that you see very nicely well done in the material nature, that is also being done by superior consciousness. This is human reasoning. How can you deny it? Can you deny it? I don't think any sane man can deny it. But similarly, as your consciousness is a symptom of your presence, you are spirit soul. Similarly, the supreme consciousness is a symptom of the supreme soul, or God, the supreme God. This is the position. Now, as consciousness, we are part and parcel of the supreme consciousness. Therefore, the whole business of our life is to dovetail our activities with the supreme plan. That is called karma yoga. That is called karma. Eka bahushyama. In the Vedic literature, you'll find that God has expanded Himself into many. Just like the father expands himself into many children. The children is nothing but expansions of the body of the father. Similarly, we all living entities, spiritual parts, all living souls, we are also expansion of the Supreme Spirit. Now, the reasoning, why the Supreme Spirit soul expanded himself into so many? What is the purpose? We have to understand. Now you can take the example. What is the purpose of father expanding himself into children? A father takes the responsibility of maintaining the children. Why? Why he takes such great responsibility, a family man? That's why his answer, just to have a happy and enjoyable life. That's all. Similarly, God has expanded into so many living entities that because he wants enjoyment. He wants enjoyment. Because you will find in the Vedic literature that the nature of God is Satchidananda Vigraha, Anandamaya Abhyasa. By nature, he is enjoying. So, we must understand that God has expanded Himself into so many living entities just for His enjoyment. Now, we are meant for, just like father is a man, yes, sons, children are meant for satisfying the father. Similarly, this is a common sense affair that we living entities, we are meant for satisfying the Supreme. That satisfaction of the Supreme can be done by a performance of yoga. That is the beginning. So here it is prescribed that yogyarthe karma karmani annatra, that is we have discussed. Yogyasistha sino santa muchyante sarva kilmisai. If we perform sacrifice for the satisfaction of the Supreme, then the result will be that we shall be free from all reaction of our sinful life. And if we do not do that, bhunjante se tadhang papa ji pachanti atmakarna. Atmakarna means simply for his own sense gratification. Now that yoga, as several times before you have explained, that asnati. Asnati means one who eats. So our yoga begins from the eating. Because eating is the first item of the necessity of our life. Eating, sleeping, fearing and making. Now eating is essential. So here in the Bhagavad Gita openly speaks that just control your eating process in the yoga. Just begin your karma yoga from the eating formula. Then gradually other things will develop. Because our senses, there are so many senses. We have got the eyes, the ear, the nose, the tongue, the hand, the leg, and so many. We have got ten senses, sensory organs and working organs. So these organs, there are, out of all the organs, the tongue is the most uncontrollable organ. Tongue. When we eat, perhaps those devotees who eat with us, we chant this, that sarira vidya jal jarandriya taheka. This body is the encasement of our nescience, of our ignorance. And in that body, the senses are our greatest enemies. Out of that, the tongue is the most powerful enemy. Tar madde jivha oti lobhamaya sudurmat. Lobhamaya sudurmat, because tongue is always hankering after palatable things. And it is making me bound up in so many reactions of my life. That is the secret. Therefore, in the Bhagavad Gita, in the beginning, the karma yoga begins with the tongue. Jagya sisto sinasam. We have to eat. Now we have to control the tongue first. How we can control the tongue? By offering sacrifice. By offering, we have to take foodstuff for maintaining our body. Now if we offer the foodstuff preparing to the Lord, that is called yoga. Yoga is not a very difficult thing. You are preparing foodstuff for eating at your home. You have simply to prepare that foodstuff in a nice way so that you can offer to Krishna. That's your process of eating or your process of securing ingredients for eating art, your cooking, nothing is stopped. Only thing is required, that instead of cooking for yourself, for the satisfaction of your tongue, you please cook it for satisfaction of Krishna and take the prasadam afterwards. Now take for example, the other day we had some feasting. We cooked it nicely and offered Krishna and then you too. What was the difficulty there? Was there any difficulty? So many gentlemen you are present here who took part of that prasadam, how nicely it was prepared and how we enjoyed. So is jagga a very difficult thing? So it is not at all difficult. Simply we have to adopt the principle. That's all. And if we adopt that principle, here it is clearly said, the jagga sisters, you know, santa, but these things are arranged by pious men and devotees of the Lord. Ordinary men, they don't care. What is this nonsense, jagga? Let us go to the hotel and get to our character. You see? That is another thing. But those who are serious about solving the problems of life, let them take to this jagga principle. Is it very difficult? Not at all. It is rather pleasurable. What do you think, Mr. Green? You are also present that day. Did you not like? So, jagga is not difficult. Now, if by doing that, jagga, if we become free from all reactions, then why should we not do it? Why should we not do it? There is no difficulty, there is no question of difficulty, rather it is a thing of pleasure, ananda. The whole thing is ananda. Ananda means pleasure, enjoyment. Spiritual life does not mean that void of enjoyment. No, it is full of enjoyment. We are seeking after enjoyment, but that enjoyment is hampered by our material existence. We do not know. We are trying to squeezing out the senses and trying to have material pleasure. This is nonsense, because we do not know what is spiritual life. Spiritual life means unlimited pleasure. There is a verse describing about Rama. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, we chant. Now what is the meaning of Rama? That is described. Ramante yogina anante satyanande chidatmani iti Rama padena so Parabrahma vidhiyate. Rama means Raman. Raman means enjoyment. So yogina. Now mind that karma yogi. Those who are yogi, those who are trying to get spiritual life, regain their spiritual vitality, they are called yogi. There are different kinds of yogi. Karma yogi, jnana yogi, Dhyana yogi, Raja yogi, the highest of all of them is the Bhakta yogi or the Bhakta. Yoginamati sarvesam madgata antaratmana saddhavan bhajati jo mam sami yukta tamo mataha. We find the highest yogi is he who is only Krishna conscious. Simply his life is full of Krishna consciousness. He is always trying to satisfy Krishna. That's all. And to satisfy Krishna is the easiest thing. Is the easiest thing of all yogic process. You haven't got to show your gymnastic power. No. Simply prepare your good foodstuff, offer to Krishna, chant Hare Krishna and enjoy life. Yoginamapi sarvisa. He is the best yogi. Best yogi. That is, you'll find it. So begin it. What is the difficulty there? So far the techniques are required. We are present. The books are there, the literature are there, the authorities are there. Simply, we have to agree, yes, yes, ma'am. Simply, you have to agree, yes. Henceforward, we shall become karma yogi. Then, from that very point, your life begins. Oh, karma yogi. Okay. Yes, ma'am, mind that. That instead of saying no to Krishna, I just like Arjuna said no in the beginning, no, sir, I am not going to fight. You don't try to induce me, my dear Krishna. He argued so many things with Krishna. And then, at the last moment, he said, yes, I shall fight. So from no man to yes man, that's all. So we have to agree. Now, we are now no man. We say everything about God, no. Now, we have to learn, yes. So you become yes man and begin this karma yoga, beginning from your life of eating, because eating you require. Without eating you cannot exist. Therefore, Bhagavad Gita teaches you that you begin your karma yoga from the point of eating. Jagya asista sino santa mucchanti sarvakilmisai bhunjante te adhang papa je pachanti atmakarana. Now, people may say, why shall I bother myself about this yoga principle? No. You have to bother yourself in the yoga principle. If you actually want to be happy, the next verse explains like this. Annad bhavanti bhutani pajanyat anna sammava jagnyat bhavati pajanya jagga karma samudhava. That why you should have to perform yoga? That is obligatory. Not that you are very kind to prepare your food stuff and offering to Krishna. It is very kind. No. It is for your interest. It is for your interest. Why? Na annad bhavanti bhutani. You have to eat. Can you say that without eating I shall continue my life? No. That is not possible. You have to eat. Annad bhavanti bhutani. If you want to exist, if you want to maintain your body and soul together, then you have to take anna. Anna means foodstuff. Or anna means grains, natural food. Then generally, anna means foodstuff, and another technical meaning of anna, anna means grains, which is produced from the land for eating of the human being. For human being, so many things are produced from the land, the grains, the fruits, the vegetables, so many things. They are meant for human beings. The grains are not meant for the tigers. The grains are meant for the human being. The fruits are meant for the dogs. The fruits are meant for the human being. The milk is produced by the cow, but it is not meant for the cow. It is meant for the human being. If you offer the milk, 30 pounds of milk, after milking the cow, and if you offer to the cow, it will refuse. It will refuse. I don't want it. Give it dry grass, it will be very glad. It will be very glad. So, everything is organized by the nature. Now, there are so many scientists, they are discovering vitamin value from foodstuff. Now, what is the vitamin value in the dry grass? Can any scientist say that this is the vitamin value in dry grass? If there is no vitamin value in dry grass, how the cow is producing so much milk which is full of vitamin C and D? How from dry grass vitamin is coming out? Nowadays, the physicians prescribe some artificial vitamins for maintaining your body. Now, what is the vitamin there in the dry grass? So that the cow is eating dry grass and giving you nice milk full of vitamin C and D, essential for your life. So these are all wrong theories, that this contains this vitamin, this contains this, let them go. But natural food stuff which is meant for human beings, they are full of vitamins. Already there, by the nature's law, by God's will. So anna bhavanti bhutan. You'll be surprised. When I was family man, I had a sermon, only 22 years old. Oh yes, too stout and strong, you see. So one day I asked him, then, his name was Buddhu. So I asked him, Buddhu, what do you take? That you are very stout and strong. So he said, my dear sir, I take only this corns. Corns. You know corns? Corns and it is powdered. The powder portion he used to make bread. And the grain portion he used to cook as rice. And he was taking that. That's all. Corn. Cornmeal, yes. And he was very stout and strong. He was deriving all the vitamins, because he was poor man. He could not eat any butter or milk or any other things, meat or no, nothing of the sort. He was simply eating. He was drawing, at that time, only 22 rupees from me. 22 rupees means, according to an American exchange, is come to $5. $5 a month, his income. And what he could spend. So he was taking the cheap food, but he was very strong and sound. The whole idea is that these grains are meant for human beings. Coarse grain or fine grain, there are so many varieties of grain, varieties of rice, varieties of grass, according. Now the fine rice, the basmati rice, the liberal class, in India, of course, we have got this distinction. They are not satisfied with this white rice. They want coarse grain for satisfaction. While gentlemen class, they cannot eat coarse grain. They want finer grain. So all these varieties of grains and vegetables and everything is there by nature's arrangement, by God's arrangement. Here it is said, anna bhavanti bhutani. Now, your body depends on the foodstuff supplied by nature. Anna bhavanti bhutani, parjannat anna sambhava. And these grains are produced by rains. Parjanna. Parjanna means regular rainfall from the sky by the arrangement of God. It is not your arrangement. Rainfall is not your arrangement. It is supernatural arrangement. If there is regular rainfall, then it can produce all the necessities of our life. I think, Karl, you are reading from the Bhagavad Gita about Maharaj Yudhishthira's reign during his kingdom, how rainfall was regular and the necessities of human being were being produced. So here is the same thing. Anna, the grains, gains our life subsistence, human being. Anna bhavanti bhutani, and grains are produced by regular rainfall. Parjannat anna sambhava. Parjanna means rainfall. And jagyat bhavati parjanna. And rainfall is produced when you offer yajna, sacrifice to the Lord. Regular rainfall will be possible when people are engaged in the yajna, otherwise nature will control rainfall. For want of rain, all your arrangement, mechanical arrangement, tractors and all these things will all fail if there is rainfall. There is no rainfall. So, control of the rainfall is not in your hand. It is in supernatural power. So here it is said that rainfall is made possible by offering yajna, by sacrifice. Padmanat, ajagnat bhavati padjanna, yajna karma samudbhuvam. And yajna is prescribed according to the Vedic rituals. Now just see the link. Living entities, they can develop by eating grains. Grains are produced by rainfall. Rainfall is made possible by offering sacrifice. And this process of sacrifice is given in authoritative scriptures like Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavad and Vedic literature. What is the process? So, because the beginning is from the Brahma, Brahma means Veda, transcendental sound. Therefore, if we work according to the direction of this Bhagavad Gita or Veda, then the whole thing becomes, spiritualized. Whole thing becomes spiritualized. Because that, karma yajna, yajna karma samudbhavam, karma. And if your karma is regulated by the direction of Krishna, just like Arjuna regulated his karma, his warfare by the direction of Krishna, then by regulation of karma, you perform yajna, sacrifice, and from for your performance of yajna, sacrifice, there is regulative rainfall, and from regulative rainfall, there is sufficient production of grain and foodstuff, and from your sufficient foodstuff, you can grow yourself, body, maintain your body very nicely. The whole program is like that. Annad bhavanti bhutani, pajjannat anna sambhava, jajjan bhavati pajjanna, jagda karma samudhavam. Karma brahma bhavam vidhi, and the nature of our karma, how we should work, that is directed in Vedic literature, just like Bhagavad Gita, just like Arjuna was directed. The karma brahma vidhi brahma akhara samudbhavam tasmat sarvagatam brahma nitya yajna pratisthitam. Therefore, my dear Arjuna, if you begin your life by performance of yajna, then that means at once your life becomes spiritualized. At once your life becomes spiritual. That's what you want. Evaṁ pravartitaṁ cakra, nānu bhakti ha, nānu bhartayati yaha ja, aghāyu indiyarāma mobhaṁ prātha sajīvati. Now here is injunction. That is the circle. That is the circle. That how to work, that injunction is there. Now why your or this work, any work, suppose you will drive in a motor car, that is a sort of work in the street. Or there is injunction that you should drive on the right. You should stop your car when there is red light. You should not proceed an inch. So many reasons. Even for your driving car, anything of your life you want to do, there are directions. Proper direction from the authority. And why not for your spiritual life? Why not for your spiritual life? You can do anything and everything what you like, what you manufacture in your own bread? No. How can you do it? In every field of your work, in practical life, you have got some direction. that you have to act in this direction. Suppose you are working, running on a factory. Oh, there are so many factory laws. Anywhere you go, there are directions from the superior authority. So, is there no direction for your spiritual realization of life? Yes, there is. We have to abide by that. Therefore, Lord says, evaṁ pravartitaṁ chakraṁ. This is a circle. Circle. That is Vedic literature, Vedic scripture. They give you direction how to work. And by working, you perform yajna. By performing yajna, you have got regular rainfall. By regular rainfall, you get production of grain. And by production of grain, you eat and live happily. So this is a circle. This is a circle. So Lord says, Lord Krishna says, evaṁ pravartitaṁ chakraṁ. Chakraṁ means circle. This is a circle. Nānu vartayati iha ja. One who does not follow this circle of activity of āyu, he is simply spoiling his life. He is simply abhayu. Abhayu means he is duration of life. He is duration of very valuable human form of life. He is simply wasting. Why? Indriya rama, simply for sense gratification like the cats and dogs and hawks. Abhayu indriya rama, mogham paksha sarujyoti. His life is now doomed. His life is now doomed. So this is the injection of Lord Krishna. Evaṁ pravartitaṁ chakraṁ nānu vartayati iha ja. Anyone who does not follow this circle of activity, then it is to be understood that he is spoiling his valuable human life and his life is doomed. Hare Krishna.